Last week was about data and collecting data, and this week is about like data analysis. So I was trying to think through like what would be a generalizable thing for like all. I'm just adding all, admit all. Okay. So I was trying to think through, you know, what would be the proper data analysis techniques that we could like go over and teach you about like statistical analysis and all that. And I was trying to prepare that. But then I sort of realized that like there's a big transformation going on and that like the right thing to do here isn't necessarily to like become an expert in one narrow domain. But it's more about like leveraging AI. So there's a lot of things that, you know, basically like one thing you could say is like, you know, to become really impactful, you want to try and get as much leverage as you can. And certainly like using a computer and not using like a pen and paper or using AI instead of using traditional methods is going to give us a lot more leverage in the DeSci space than trying to do something easy or normal. So actually a while back, I did this like science fair project. It was at a DeSci event and I made like this like volcano and I'll send out the link in a second to the YouTube, but basically like I made this volcano and like I collected one data point and I put the data point into ChatGPT and it started like analyzing just this one data point. And I thought this was actually like really cool because it showed that like it could sort of make inferences about things. And the other thing that was really interesting about it is like when you have a data in a spreadsheet or data in a like a database or something, it doesn't have any contextual data. So there's this concept in AI called like an embedding. And that means that like you add in a lot of external information. So imagine, to give it like a concrete example, imagine you just had a database of animals and in the database, it has like cat. And then someone searches for kitten, like that doesn't come up because it's not like a match. But with embeddings, what you can do is you can sort of take that word cat and embed it in this larger context, which gives you context basically. And the reason this is really helpful is because now when you search for kitten, cat will come up. But the same principle applies to a lot of other things. So if you had like some text in the database, you can all of a sudden, or like movies, you can now, if you just have movie titles, you can say like, what are the best movies in this database by like plot development or something, or by, you know, rank, you just have a bunch of movies in the database and you say like, return the movies ranked by year they were released. And you can, and the database will actually do that because it has this, all this contextual data. And the same principle actually applies for a lot of scientific data. And I don't think people are sort of using this. I mean, it's a new thing, people are, but I think this is something that we can really take advantage of. The other thing that's really cool about using AI to analyze data is there's this concept of like attention in an AI model where you basically like link lots and lots of data together and let the computer find inferences. And I think there's like a similar thing here. Like a human would try 10 different inferences, 10 different statistical methods on something, and they wouldn't really know which was the best one. But with AI, you can sort of just apply all of them at the same time and let it pop out what is the right thing. So you can find things that maybe necessarily like a human wouldn't find. You can also automate data analysis. So it just makes things a lot easier. AI will give you better predictive modeling than like what you can typically do. You can start using a lot more free text response. So a lot of times like research is really great for some, like a lot of times researchers don't want to use free text because it's hard to code properly. So they end up using like a Likert scale. But the problem with a Likert scale is that a lot of stuff is lost in that. And also I think a lot of people just like power through it and you get like no actual information out of it, in my experience with it. So free text, at least you can see if someone's like paying attention a lot more and it forces someone to think. And if you can tell easily that they're not, you can sort of discard that data. If it's just trash data and you can, it's just random gibberish. But you can't easily tell that with a Likert scale. So you can start to use more complicated multimodal types of inputs using AI, which is sort of the point I'm trying to make. And you can also do real-time stuff. So as the data is coming in, you can actually analyze it in real time. And what's really cool is like we have ChatGPT, of course, but then there's this even more recent thing called Code Interpreter, which was recently released by OpenAI. And what's really cool about Code Interpreter is that you can start to analyze large data sets, you know, because it's actually like writing code for you. And to give you an example, like you can say like count the number of words in this paragraph and it says 100 words because it doesn't know how to do, like the problem with like a large language model is it doesn't necessarily know how to do math. But what the large language model is actually really good at doing is it's actually really good at writing code, which can then do the math properly and then spit out the right answer. So you see here, he asks it and it says 100. And here he says, do it again, but use a code interpreter. And it writes the code and then it gets the right answer, which is 104. So this ability for an LLM to write code to do analysis is really powerful. So it can do math. So some of the benefits of this is it can do math. You can upload data sets. So you can upload an XML file, a JSON file, a CSV file, a video file, lots of different things. And then you can say like, analyze this video. And it knows how to import the FFmpeg or the proper library to crop or segment it, perhaps. It writes code, so it can get more accurate information out of the data than what you could do just using an LLM. Lower hallucinations, this isn't as important. You don't have to know how to write code, which I think is great for opening up science to more people. So obviously, like code isn't like the most impossible thing, but it's still annoying if you know, writing 100 lines could still take it. A significant amount of time. So this just expands that out to many more people. What else is really cool about Code Interpreter is it's less about like prompt crafting. Because like, you know, if you've ever used GPT, it's like, oh, like it takes forever, blah, 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 to like get the right prompt and to make it. This is more of like an interactive thing where you can sort of analyze the data iteratively, which is very cool. You can do real-time analysis. You can start to do new things that weren't possible before. So like real-time analysis, you can use multimodal. So like text plus images together or free response or using these embeddings, which weren't really utilized as much before. And you can start to find things that maybe are sort of go beyond this or superhuman. So that go beyond a normal person's ability to conduct research. And I think like the other good thing that's working in our advantage is I think this will be sort of not appreciated by traditional academia because it's a new way of doing things. And you know, I think some research labs will probably adopt it, but I think if I had to guess, a lot of research labs and universities aren't going to do it and they're gonna stick with the status quo. So this gives us some leverage and some ability to try new things that aren't necessarily being done, which will help sort of the DeSci cause and help to make all of you more successful. And it's pretty easy to do too. So I'll give some examples of how it works. So this is an example of unstructured text. Let me see if I can see this a little bit better. So here he uploads some text in it. He uploads just a bunch of text into it and he asks the computer to like put it into a table format, and it just automatically like finds all these insights for him. And you can find out more about this here. Here's like if people doing economic research, he asks it to map out the Bitcoin data set and do analysis that. You can find more information about that here. This user asks them to classify 300 hours of Spotify playlists and get like psychographic data and map it onto something. So this is like a new way of like transforming playlist data into user data. So if someone had a something about that, that's pretty cool. This person used genomic data. So for people that are doing genomic data sets here, he just uploads it to a genomic text file to it, and then it accurately predicts traits like caffeine consumption and muscle composition. You know, I don't know if this is like accurate or not, but it's certainly worth trying and validating the accuracy of. Sociological data, someone took all the crime in SF in a CSV file and just automatically like visualized it, which is very cool. UFO sightings, so someone took all the UFO sightings and visualized it on an asset to build an HTML heat map, which is very cool. You can find out more here. And here is a really good resource I found, which sort of walks you through how to do it. Code Interpreter is only available on ChatGPT Pro, which is $20 a month, so everyone should probably get that. They're rolling it out slowly over the course of the week. So this is like brand new, hot off the press. But I think this is a really cool thing. So next week, what we're going to do is we're going to take this data point that we analyzed this week and convert that in. And we're going to talk about sort of what sort of data analysis techniques worked and what sort of data analysis techniques didn't work. What kind of analysis you did. So everyone should share something that worked and didn't work. So it's pretty standard what we've been doing before, what worked, what you did, what worked, what didn't work. Try and connect as much as possible with another team. It would be great if all the teams are talking to each other. And submit it here by Tuesday at noon, and we will do the same thing. Does anyone have any questions on that?
So I've been... Whoever else, I'm assuming, Michael, you're probably on the pro or plus tier with OpenAI. Do you get access to all the plugins right away? I know there's like a wait list. I don't know if that applies to like all these plugins or.
Yeah, so they're just, I have access to it, but they're just releasing it to everyone this week. Like okay. They made an announcement that Code Interpreter is going to be available to everybody. So. Like literally this week. So this is a very new thing that everyone should jump on. I don't know exactly when it's going to roll out, but it seems like it's imminent this week. That's what the announcement said. That's what Greg Brockman tweeted.
I'm curious, just curious how like journals, peer review journals are going to like start requiring, you know, validations of projects that are sort of built on these plugins, just because of this maybe slim chance of, you know, hallucinations and stuff working with.
You can always ask it to export its code, so it's not too big of an issue.
Right.
And then you're just like building the code automatically. I mean, traditional research is going to have bugs as well. So I think same rules apply that you have to double check it. Mm-hmm. This will just make it go, this will just, help in automating it and make it go faster. Anybody else? Randomly call people. Elijah, Danica, this might be really, I tried to find stuff for each project. So Danica with the sociology stuff, Elijah with the genome stuff, and Gavin and Jackson and Joel. The UFO stuff, Jackson with the other visualization, Julian also, Ledger back with the free text stuff. I think that'll be really helpful for you, using it for like free text interpretation. Rakan with the data analysis stuff, Tristan also with the visualization. But so I would say give it a try. Does anyone else have any one more question? All right. 3, 2, 1. All right, then we will jump in here with Cannabis DAO.
Hello.
For this week.
Oh, we are Cannabis DAO. Today, I'd like to share our revised research question and data to test the hypothesis. Part 1. What kind of data did you collect? We revised our research question. We aim to investigate whether researchers receiving NIH research grants in the cannabis field would be interested in, and potentially join, the Cannabis DAO initiative. As a metric for the verification results, we will use the actual number of people who joined the DAO. In other words, we will examine the following 4 points. 1. Does the ability to apply without a bank account increase the incentive for researchers to apply? 2. Does the simplification of application document preparation increase the incentive for researchers to apply? 3. Does the disclosure of the evaluation criteria and process increase the incentive for researchers to apply? 4. Does the shortening of the period from application to completion of review increase the incentive for researchers to apply? Part 2. What worked for collecting data? It worked to ask those researchers who already know us. We invited researchers who already connected with us, and they resonated with the concept of the DAO and decided to participate. Part 3. What didn't work for collecting data? It doesn't mean it didn't work, but it is taking time to get data from researchers who don't know us well. We will collect data using the page where NIH's funding history is posted. Specifically, we will extract the email addresses of the funded cannabis researchers from the page and reach out to them with an explanation of the DAO and an invitation to participate. We assume this will allow us to verify the hypothesis with thousands of people. When the results are obtained to some extent, we will be able to answer our research question. Part 4. Connect and share with one other group in Psi Combinator and chat about data. We got many insights from the conversation with Elijah of CGD. That's it. Thank you so much.
Awesome. Do we have anyone here from Cannabis DAO? Gavin, are you there?
Hey, yes, I'm here.
Okay. Does anyone have any questions for Gavin?
Who don't know as well.
So did you actually were you able to email
ask those researchers who all
yeah I think we've started emailing I think look, I guess what's interesting about cannabis is that there are different motives behind the research, and a lot of what's funded through the NIH focuses on the harms, and I'm quite keen to get researchers who are focused on the benefits of cannabis. And so, yeah, I've started reaching out to my own network. I guess I've been in this space for a few years to try and figure out if there are researchers who want to come and participate in Cannabis DAO, focused much more on the benefits of cannabis than the harms.
Got it. I mean, got it. Were you able to collect one data point?
I wasn't personally. I know they've reached out. I know the DAO has reached out to researchers to ask about data they want to collect, but yeah, as yet I haven't collected any myself.
Got it. I mean, so let's I think it would be great to I just want to see like the form of the data and like what it looks like, and you know, just, I mean, I don't want to see it, but just so that you guys have thought through it a little bit more.
Yeah.
Cool. Does anyone else have any questions for the cannabis team?
Yeah, I had a question. So I actually have two questions. So if I remember correctly, you position yourself as a Vita DAO for cannabis. Mm-hmm. So basically you want to fund cannabis research, but so you said that you are reaching out to scientists and you want them to apply for funding, or they want some other type of help? And the second question is, when you reach out to scientists, do you do this bulk emailing, or do you do some kind of personalization? And if it's the latter, how do you approach it?
Yeah, no, it has to be personalized, and it's based on their research area and the indication that they're looking at and the geography that they're in. And there's, I guess what's quite challenging about cannabis research is in many countries and in many geographies, it's still illegal. Or very challenging to do because cannabis is still a Schedule I drug. So it requires that personal outreach. Yeah.
Nice.
Okay, and on the first question, so you want to have scientists in the DAO, and so your thinking is that they're going to contribute in what capacity?
Yeah, so what, look, what's interesting about cannabis research is that historically it's been quite challenging to fund. And it, similar to VitaDAO, I guess, it doesn't fit the economic incentives of traditional drug development or research. And that's why DeSci is particularly interesting. So yeah, when we reach out to scientists, it's often scientists who are lacking funding and look at DeSci as a way to secure the funding they need to do the research that they want to undertake. Does that make sense?
Yes, totally. Thanks.
Yeah. Got it. Anyone else? Cool. All right. Good. And I think you have a, I like this new direction you guys are going with the science. That's excellent. Cool. All right. Next up, we have Tristan.
This is Tristan with the
Research Collective.
Research Collective. For this last assignment, I created a kind of like an interest gauging form for the different meetup groups that I'm in. I'm moving away from Austin, and so I'm trying to consolidate different meetup groups. And so I decided to like email them, telling them that move to this place, but also if you want to join us online, fill out this form. And so at the end of the form is a link to the Research Collective's Telegram group. But hopefully along the way, they will also give some information about like what they're working on and how a scientific community can benefit them. And then also whether or not they are willing to participate in decentralized trials. So I think last night I sent this out to two smaller meetup groups. I'm gonna send it to a larger one and my like kind of my personal email address, and then probably also share it to the Telegram group I'm in. It's still not quite solving the problem of like trying to get members to be more of a leadership role, but I think this will help figure out like what needs are not being met and how we can potentially coordinate together to fulfill those needs.
Cool. Tristan, are you here? Tristan said he was bike. Yep. Your mic is on, so it sounds like you're here. We can't hear you though. But it looks like you're trying to speak.
Scientific community.
Tristan. Does anyone, okay, so while he's figuring that out, does anyone have a question for Tristan? I'm just trying to read the questions here. Let me just see if I can figure this out. Which biohacking science, which scientific or entrepreneurial? How could a scientific minded project? So Tristan, have you changed the scope here a little bit from trying to figure out like decentralized clinical trials versus normalized clinical trials to more of a community building exercise here?
I'm going to put that research agenda into projects that I'm nearby and maybe have one variable in each of them. Like, were they offered escrow? Were they offered tokens? Like, what kind of incentive was being used? And because I feel like I can't do one that has a large enough number size to do all of these conditions. I'm going to need to do one that like just kind of ride on to other studies with one variable, and then use that to figure out what is the best to focus on later.
I mean, it sounds good. I mean, I think also you don't have to actually do it. I think even doing a survey, if people would be interested in it, is like a great first step. Like even collecting that data would be a powerful, would be even actually like fantastic, because then you could use that data to be like, oh, maybe you could show that to other people and be like, yeah, look, I have this data from, you know, cohort of people that are in the target demographic and they've expressed interest in this. And I think that would actually be like pretty good.
Yeah. So I feel like the ride-ons can do that, but then the actual studies that are collecting biomedical data over time, I have like two good leads on them, but they're not going to be probably done in the next month or so. So I'm thinking of maybe focusing on writing up a request for proposal or for DeSci Labs and having a sort of system to build this into that so that the person who controls the access to the scientific object is able to then validate if they think that this person's data that they submitted is real. And if it is real, then it gets attached to the data object.
Got it. I mean, sounds cool. Just make sure to manage complexity.
I'm trying to like figure out the right sequence of things right now. And like last night was just like, I'm leaving Austin. I need to like take care of some stuff. So yeah, I feel you.
Yeah. I mean, I think all these things sound cool. I would just like try and go, I mean, you use any hook and crook possible to, you know, every new thing adds another barrier and possible thing that can break. So just keep in mind your like your whatever it's called, funnel, whatever the funnel is called, user funnel. Yes, or whatever. Yeah. Julian, other team, do you have any feedback?
Yeah, I mean, I think the thing of like keeping it simple is it's just in general, I feel like things get really complex with trials. There's a lot of people to manage. that's kind of, I don't know, one of the incentive things I worry about is just like, I think that people in these trials, you know, like we're thinking about it 24/7, but if you're a participant, or even if you're like a lab running a trial, it's just like one thing on your plate. So yeah, keeping surveys as simple as possible and keeping the clinical trial, like what innovation you have, as simple as possible, I think is really valuable.
Gavin, do you have anything? Gavin has experience in clinical trials.
Yeah. Nothing to add here, no.
Okay, awesome.
I'm curious to just hear, you know, over time, just like sort of qualitative interviews or just, you know, what you pick up on among project leaders to see like how closely their intuitions matched with the data that you collect. Like, because I would imagine that for a lot of project leaders, they're like, yeah, you know, I kind of realized like halfway along the way that I should have incentivized more here, or they didn't really, you know, take the bait here. And, you know, I'm curious to see like how much the results are like a surprise or insightful to their project leaders too, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that makes sense. I guess my concern is that the survey data is not going to be as useful as what's tacked onto an actual decentralized trial. Like the data from that and comparing is what's going to be really impressive.
True, but if you can't get that other data, that if you can get this data but you can't get the other data, then maybe it's better.
Yeah. I think I might like kind of create like the article for the end of this capstone that explains the process into detail, but doesn't necessarily how to do it, implement it in a concrete way, and include that survey for asking other DAO participants about incentivization. I think that could be a good combo.
Oh, that could be good. Yeah, I mean, you don't have to look. You don't have to save the world here. Like, be realistic and like, yeah. I think if you just put out what you learned so far, that's good. The other thing I wanted to say is like, think about like a free. Sometimes surveys can be really annoying. Think about like a free text response of like two or three questions that you maybe just email to people or something and have them write it up. People you know. And then they can fill out it, and then you could take that and put it into ChatGPT and try and do something interesting there on the data analysis side. Like maybe there's ways of going outside of a traditional survey to collect this data to like, maybe you can get smaller samples, but like with more high fidelity stuff and use GPT as like a new way of analyzing it.
Yeah, that could be fun doing sentiment analysis on.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Something like that could be like really experimental and interesting as a way to like answer your scientific question here. Cool. Okay. Excellent work there, Tristan. Let's all give him a round of applause. And next up we have, I see lots of applauses there. All right. Next up we have Joel with Future Folklore.
Hey, Joel here with Future Folklore. As you can imagine, it's tough to come up with just one data point in a quick turnaround. When it comes to the search for other life, But there is one lead, and it's through a new friend of the project named Jared. He's done some interesting work around coming up with hypothesis-driven research, and even we're talking about some tech ideas related to sightings of unusual aerial objects. And he's put together some consistent reports of there being signals emitted and detected in the 1 to 3 gigahertz frequency range, and even some more precise, consistently reported signals within that narrow bandwidth. And this came up even during NASA's one-day conference on this subject a number of weeks ago. So it's a really fun lead. This is exactly what Future Folklore is aiming at, new tech ideas surrounding the search for other life.
Excellent. Good video. Anyone have any questions or comments for Joel? Joel, are you here? Joel. Yeah. So are you collecting, do you want to collect like his location when he saw that, or like the frequency of the thing that he saw, or? Well,
it's a little bit secondhand right now. I mean, there are multiple reports saying that these objects are emitting signals in that bandwidth. So it's not data that this person himself has collected firsthand. But it's sort of a lead, you know. It's data that's sort of out there in the public domain that we want to follow up on.
Got it.
But it's fairly easy to collect. So
cool. Did you see that slide I presented with the UFO sightings?
Yeah, I've seen that one. Yeah, I've seen it before. Yeah.
On like, and so they use ChatGPT to like map it out. That's kind of cool.
Yeah, and when So this data set we could collect, you know, by giving or just telling people to go out with like, you know, simple radio devices and just go hang out, you know, and sort of open source that data. So it's pretty tractable, I think.
That could work. I mean, I think like just a form, you know, asking people to have, I don't know what the device is, but like the device and measuring, and then you could map it, and maybe like if everyone's seeing it in like one place, that would be really interesting.
Yeah,
or like there's one specific frequency that is particularly active.
Yeah, we'd get a good like random sample of just the noise, and then if anybody can associate sightings, you know, I also saw this with my eyes, I don't know what it was, and then correlate that with the data that they collected passively.
That is great. Jackson, Julian, Ledger back, Peter, Tristan, Khan. Do you guys have comments for Joel? Elijah, Danica.
I'll share the slide in the group chat that was from the NASA conference. Pretty wild stuff.
Cool. Jackson, go ahead.
I don't have a direct question based on the video, Joel, but I'd be really curious to know, like, what is the most interesting conclusive evidence you have on the subject you're researching? I just like think it would be interesting if you could post it like on the side in the chat or something. That'd be great.
Yeah, thanks. I'll post a couple interesting points for sure.
Cool. Thanks.
Awesome. Well, we are looking forward to that. And next up, we have Danica, who is doing...
Hi, everyone. I'm Danica Wilbank.
There we go. Danica with, of course, SoSci Dow.
With SoSci Dow. And today I'll be sharing some very preliminary insights from our Dow survey looking at the beliefs. And visions for the future of DAO members. We only have 6 responses so far, which I don't think is going to be representative of the DAO member full population. So I'll be focusing on a few responses to these 2 open-ended questions: how people see DAOs interacting with existing structures like nations and corporations in the future, and how people think DAOs will change social networks and human relationships. These responses come from members of Kongland, which is a DAO working to create secure element microchips that help bring objects in the real world onto the blockchain. So for the first question about DAOs interacting with existing structures One person thought they'll be similar to unions, so perhaps counterbalancing the power of nations and corporations. Another person thought they could take many forms, either as corporations, revolutionary parties, cartels, religions, or suzerains. Another person thinks that they'll be paying a lot of taxes. DAOs aren't sovereign any more than corporations are sovereign, but that they could have certain domains where they could be more sovereign, like the metaverse. That if the nation state doesn't concern itself much with the metaverse, DAOs will be left to their own devices to manage their own environment. And then I thought this contrast was kind of amusing. One person thought that DAOs will be the nations and corporations of the future, whereas another thought that DAOs are just Discord servers with the treasury. And I don't think that's the right structure to affect change. So a lot of variety in how people view the role of DAOs and how powerful they are. For the next question about DAOs changing social networks and human relationships, one person thought they probably won't change that much. They might create more room for people to adopt more responsibility than they could have otherwise, just because there will still be the need for the same structures within groups for them to function. They won't change all that much. Another person thought they might introduce fairness to otherwise unfair systems. Another person thought that DAOs might have a big impact on human relationships and allow people to connect more and build relationships throughout the earth. Whereas another person said possibly that they see DAOs as more of an extension of what the internet started, but that it is interesting to think more generally about how internet structures can recreate older social structures like religions and social clubs on the internet. So from these first six responses, we can see there's already a wide variety in how DAO members view the role of DAOs and how impactful people think DAOs are and will be in the future. So I'm excited to hopefully see more responses roll in.
Really good data there, Danica. That's amazing that you got so much.
Yeah, thank you. I got these about a month ago, but I hadn't had a chance to like really look over them yet. So this is a good opportunity.
Oh, of course. I mean, that's still really, and do you have like demographic data for those people?
I do. I would have to look it up though.
Okay, that's fine. But as long as you have it, that's really interesting. Do people have questions for Danica?
That's really provocative, intriguing data. Really, really great start. I'm curious, Danica, did you collect anything related to like how long they've been involved in DAOs? I'm just kind of curious, like, is there sort of an idealism right out of the gate that kind of, you know, goes different ways into like the cynical or the sort of reduced view of DAOs, or yeah, just wondering about that.
Yeah, that would be really interesting. I didn't, but this is an older version of the survey. I'm making a new one to put on DBDAO. And so I will add that question because I think that's definitely worth knowing.
Amazing. This is a, and I, how do you think, how are you thinking about going about analyzing this? Because like, it's so disparate. How do you summarize it or something like that?
Yeah, I think like you were saying, it's always easier to present, or usually easier to present Likert scale question results because you have these neat little boxes and you can easily show plots. I'm curious to use more GPT text analysis. I've used a lot of sentiment analysis in the past, but I haven't tried GPT yet, but I've heard from people doing similar analyses. They found it more reliable than some of the older methods. I think in this first pass, I was kind of just looking for patterns and like differences. And the ones that stuck out just with these first six was like, just, you know, some people think DAOs are going to be really impactful and change things. Others think they won't. And there's not that much we can gauge from just the first six, I think.
I would be curious what would happen is if you plugged all these different things into ChatGPT and said, like, do analysis and write a report, like, what it would do. Like, if it could figure out, like, if you also gave it the demographic data, like, just going, like, full AI on it.
I love that idea. Yeah.
Just, like, go to the year 3000 instantaneously. I think it's just an interesting thing to compare and contrast it with, like, you know, your own personal insights. But I mean, that's just more like a meta science. But this is amazing, really cool stuff. I think this is really cool. Nice. Did anyone else? I'm surprised at just like the diversity of like
for the next question about DAO
of responses here, of even how like I would have expected for it to be more similar, but like people really had a gamut of like it was gonna change the world versus it's like it's a internet forum, it's a Yahoo chat board or something, you know.
Right, like even within the same DAO, like I expect a lot of variety across DAOs, but even within one, a lot of differences.
Yeah. I didn't make catch this, but are this all from within one DAO or is this across multiple DAOs?
This is from within Conland, from one DAO.
Got it. That's really interesting. I mean, that's cool that it's within. I think, you know, you could also down the road, maybe this is a good or bad idea, but you'd also see like maybe you know, how it differs between DAOs too, but you don't necessarily need that right now. But this is, yeah, it's amazing there's such diversity of thought there. Anyone else?
It makes me wonder along the lines of like the cross DAO comparison, just like how people's sentiments toward DAOs in general tracks with like how tractable the problem is that the DAO is trying to solve. Like if it's just like climate DAO, the whole climate, or if it's like focus on a very specific task that is like, you know, you can get traction on. I wonder just how much their attitude toward DAOs kind of maps onto that. But anyway, for another time. Yeah.
I met with Charles last week and we talked about hopefully if I can get enough data points from multiple DAOs, we could compare what I find with his data on the structures of DAOs and see if there are relationships between what individual members believe in the structure of DAOs and like you said, what the DAOs are doing. That would be cool if there's something there.
Charles, do you have anything you wanted to add to this?
I mean, other than it's a pretty awesome survey. I didn't really have just like a lot of comments right now. There's not necessarily like a lot of data yet to come in. So I'm kind of just kind of waiting for a little bit more to come out before I say anything.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I think like even for like preliminary results here, preliminary results are always just very valuable also because then, you know, people can add to it later on, especially in the DeSci context. Like people want to add to an existing thing more than they want to just dump data into sort of an unknown. But I think it's excellent. So really good, excellent. A lot of virtual applause for Danica there. Okay.
Hi.
Next up we have Supplement DAO with the Supplement DAO people.
It's Darian here with Supplement DAO, reporting on the last 2 days.
Jackson and Darian.
So in the last 2 days, we created a quiz and gathered data from our first three responders. A few takeaways over this period of time. So first of all, creating a quiz for anonymous qualitative data is really hard, especially when it's adjacent to medical data. We went through 4 revisions, making our answers more freeform and improving anonymity each time. Gathering responses on this type of data requires a lot of trust and can make some people uncomfortable. In terms of next steps, we're going to continue to gather data with this current form, but we've learned that this data is complicated enough and it requires enough trust and explanation that a custom website or web portal is required. We also found that we were continually gathering bio data for each supplement entry. So that means every time somebody would fill out information for a supplement, they were also filling out information on their bio data, which is not necessary if we had a custom website. So that's our next step in terms of data gathering. Asks for this community, we'd appreciate it if you looked at the quiz in Telegram and responded with any responses plus any feedback you have for the quiz. It's definitely a work in progress, and we appreciate any help, feedback at all in that direction. Thank you.
Awesome. Does anyone have any questions? Jackson, are you here?
Yeah, I'm here. Darian wasn't able to make it today.
Sweet. Anyone have any questions for Jackson? So you have go ahead.
Yeah, I was just wondering, considering the service is taking in like actual like medical data, you know, are you guys gonna add any like privacy measures so you know, don't run the risk of you know, having a data set full of, you know, people's medical data and something, you know, happening with it.
So right now we're not collecting, we're collecting bio data such as like age range and overall gender, but not anything that could be linked back to a person individually. No email addresses at this point. Very preliminarily, we're just looking for some demographic data, but not data that could be used to identify a person necessarily.
Why did you guys choose all going after sort of all supplements as opposed to sort of targeting one?
We left the this initial survey open form just because we were looking for participation where if you were going for a very specific supplement, even if it was a very popular one, it could lower the amount of survey results, whereas leaving it long form and allowing people that, you know, could take a wide range of supplements or maybe supplements that aren't as popular to also engage with this initial survey was kind of the goal.
Got it. Do you notice any sort of clustering around? Were you able to collect any data?
We did collect some data, not enough to make any like statistical analysis on going after an initial first supplement. I think we're going to go off of overall trend data, like Google Trends, to pick like the most popular ones when we do start targeting for specifics.
Got it. Is anyone else? Julian, Joel?
I'm curious, you know, just people's own perception of how they feel like when they take supplements, or I don't know if the question gets at this, I need to look at it, but like just the perceived felt value of having taken them, whatever they are, right? Or having missed them, like do they feel like, oh, I start to feel worse, or I start to like attribute certain symptoms because I missed my supplements? That could be interesting just with supplements in general, right? Like whatever they are.
Yeah, of course. I think we are really looking for like the qualitative experience, you know. We're not trying to get like, oh, you took a blood test after getting this supplement, what's like your levels of like cholesterol or something in your blood. It's more of like, how have you felt qualitatively over the time that you took it? And yeah, I think adding an experience, if people say, oh, I stopped and I immediately had, you know, a really negative reaction, I think that'd be important to capture also.
Anybody else? Awesome. Well, good work on getting the survey. I mean, I think the website is interesting. I don't know. Could you explain Darian's logic there?
Yeah. So what he's getting at is that, you know, if we did eventually enact, you know, more of a profile-based experience where you can interlink different supplements you've taken, and have all those experiences connected to a profile that, you know, could be shared privately or publicly, depending on your personal preference. It would be easier to kind of create an overall experience, especially if you're taking multiple different types of supplements at once. When you were talking about bio data, like those initial, you know, age, demographic, gender, you'd have to fill that out on this long form survey every single time, even if you're taking multiple supplements. So it becomes redundant. And I think a website experience would be better for collecting data.
Got it. I mean, I think also, like I would say, you know, my opinion, but something to keep in mind, like what we talked about with Tristan is like, don't necessarily start building like intensely complicated things for people who want to put in 10 things if it's not really like a need, but up to you.
Danica, go ahead.
Oh, I was going to ask like another cool use case for GPT here could be like putting reviews through GPT or analyzing reviews and seeing what comes out.
Yeah, 100%. Looking for like specific keywords, you know, like if the experience is overall beneficial, grading it on a scale of like a beneficial experience to a negative experience, GPT would definitely be very useful, I think.
Anybody else? Cool. Well, I think it's really good. I mean, going back on what I said before, I mean, I know within like nootropics and like stuff like that, like the stacks people take, like how things interact with each other is like a very important thing to measure, isn't it?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. Of course. So, I mean, I don't know. I guess it depends. Like maybe it is a good idea, but yeah, interesting. Are there common stacks that like everyone tends to take, or is like what stacks people take a variable as well?
I think they're relative from what I've seen, being involved in some of the communities. It can be very variable, including like stuff that, you know, wouldn't be commonly seen in the supplement space at all. You know, some people like to try things that are very, very new. But there is usually some mainstays, like some of the more critical vitamins and minerals. Those are usually pretty common.
Got it. Okay, cool. Awesome. Mm-hmm. All right. Great work. We will give you a digital applause as well.
Thanks, everybody.
Next up, we have Charles with distributed governance.
Oops. So this is my response for the
put you back at the beginning here.
Hi, this is Charles Ojibwe with the distributed governance for framework projects. And so this is my response for the fourth video. On data collection. The data I've primarily collected is mostly documents of various media types, some web pages, forum posts.
Second to buffer here. Start you back at the beginning.
Mostly documents of various.
I don't know what's going on. Charles, your videos always seem to lag. I don't know why. One more second here. Let's try this. Just refresh it. We'll pause it. We'll give it a second. We'll let it go ahead. Let it buffer a little bit. Buffer, buffer, buffer.
Hi, this is Charles Ojibwe with the distributed governance score framework projects, and so this is my response for the fourth video on data collection. The data I've primarily collected is mostly documents of various media types, some web pages, forum posts, research papers, reports, and whatnot, but primarily documents, and also got some new potential questions to consider for the projects on thanks to DACA. What worked for collecting data? Primarily, most of my data is not really picked up from potential subjects. Mostly, it's just searching and curating documents online. So what's really kind of worked there is just looking for appropriate documents and curating them. And you know what didn't work for collecting data? I can't really say much, just because primarily most of the data collection is primarily just documents. But regarding again like new questions or getting people to review. I would say what really hasn't worked well is just kind of leaving it up to people just to find the project and submit questions. It's probably going to be better to just actually talk to people and directly message them. And the group I connected with Denica, I work in the Kurtzel Political Survey. She submitted two questions to consider to the DAO Index, which was extremely helpful. And there were some really good questions.
Okay, what does it mean, a document for a DAO?
Yeah, so a document for a DAO just refers to primarily a document that they use. So it could be, for example, like their docs. So go to their wiki. They might have a document talking about their governance processes. So that could be one. It could also be a blog post. I mean, pretty much anything you would kind of consider a document. But really any media types would technically work.
Got it. What types of things are typically said in a document?
Well, depending on the question I'm trying to answer, usually I look for a document which actually provides the relevant information. So, if I'm looking at whether a DAO has a a code of conduct or a similar document, I start searching. All right, so did they have a document called code of conduct? If not, is there something else which is pretty similar to that? And then that's usually answers the question. Or sometimes you don't have specific documents or at least specific sections. So sometimes you have to look at different documents which are in different areas and see if those have the information I'm looking for to answer the question.
Got it. Cool. Danica, did you want to say anything or anyone else?
I'm just really excited to see what you find. I think we had a really good conversation the other week, and something I pointed out then is I feel like you're making a really good resource for people, especially if they are not super familiar with DAOs, just have all this information in one place. I'm looking forward to seeing what you find.
Yeah, thanks for the comment, Danica. Actually, I just realized this. Just unfortunately, I have to make this real kind of quick because I had to move some things. But I really forgot to include the survey and the form for the questions actually in the video. So sorry about that, but that would have been a lot more informative.
Got it. Next time, or feel free to send them in the chat. Let's see, does anyone else have any?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, go ahead.
One quick question. So do you think that data originating from web documents is somehow different from data generated by real users, real people? Can they be regarded as replacements of each other?
I wouldn't say they're necessarily replacements for each other, because usually, pretty much all even if the document itself is just user generated. People who run the DAO write the documents. It's not necessarily the same that you'd find in a forum, but I use forum posts as well. Pretty much anything, anything where I can use to answer a question, I'm pretty much going to use it. Usually the quality is a lot better for a well prepared document than you would get with just a forum post. I think that's pretty much really the only kind of difference is just the one's probably higher quality than the other.
Thanks.
Excellent. And I think ChatGPT will also are you planning on using ChatGPT to analyze some of the data?
It can save me some time. Yeah, I'm definitely gonna use it.
Awesome. Very cool. I think I'm very curious to see if it's able to extract out information, because you're gonna have so many documents, that it'll probably just be great at that.
Yeah.
Awesome. Nice work, Charles. We'll give you all a digital applause here. And next up, we have Julian.
Hey guys, Julian here with
Voluntas.
Hey guys, Julian here with Voluntas. So I'm just sharing with you a little kind of study that we're doing with a company that we know that does cardiac rehab. So basically, part of our approach is we have experience building a traditional clinical trial recruitment business? Can we kind of supercharge that with some of these DeSci tools? And so one thing we're doing here is kind of saying, okay, let's just like get started with recruiting folks. So this is like basically a landing page for this this study. It's kind of a...
We'll just give it 10 seconds here. So we're secondhand tobacco smoke, cardiovascular disease, and we have the landing page. Okay.
Pretty general studies. So like, you know, it should be easier to find people that meet this criteria than for like a rare disease study. And so I think the question for us, the data point is kind of like, okay, what's the cost of this, right? We have a sense of like from our past experience, but kind of what is it now? And we found it to be a few hundred bucks per recruited patient, right? So the way that works is kind of you're running, in our case, Facebook ads. You're paying, you know, a certain amount for those, and then there's a funnel. So a certain, I can look it up and share it offline if you're curious, like people click on the Facebook ad into this, and then some people actually sign up the our landing page. And the interesting data point is kind of like one in five people approximately who sign up for this, like on that link, actually participate in the study. So, you know, it's not bad, but a few hundred bucks for a simple study like this is not cheap. You know, it's still profitable for us because like, you know, they really want to do the study. They really want to find people who are going to do it. But I think part of what we're working on is there a better way to recruit people at lower cost that is more advantageous kind of across the board?
Got it. Does anyone have any questions for Voluntas and Julian? Julian's here.
Yeah, and one thing I'd add is just that's kind of the traditional, like, it's kind of such a, well, it's not super old school, but like when you think of clinical trial recruitment, it's literally, like if you search for a keyword for a disease, you'll often find clinical trial ads, and those search ads are pretty expensive, right? So that's why like the cost is actually pretty high. And like even for a simple study like this, it's kind of like, oh wow, that's a lot of money, right? But people are desperate for patients even for simple studies, so that's why that.
We're hackage.
Got it. I see. And so wait, how do you get around the problem of it being expensive to recruit people using Facebook links though?
So I think the idea with this DeSci concept is like, if you build a community and a database of like a registry, right? So there's all these registries for diseases, and some clinical trials use registries to recruit patients. So it's like, if you have 100,000 folks who are just like in your registry and have kind of signaled interest in clinical trials, then you can just like reach out to them and say, hey, this might be of interest, right? Versus with targeted ads, it's like, Facebook and Google know that people will pay a lot for this. So the idea is like, can you, with a kind of new incentive model, build up this network of folks so that you can, you know, not have to use these like expensive outbound techniques.
Okay. So, but what would be like a data point that you could collect to try and prove this?
So I think that I think this is kind of like the control of like, okay, it's like, there's a cost to running Facebook ads. It's a few, you know, it ranges from like a few hundred, like $100, $200 for simple studies to like to find rare disease patients. It can be like $1,000 or $2,000 even. And then yeah, I think that's kind of the, like, to compare it to the DeSci concept is kind of like, okay, how do we quantify our costs, right? Like there's a token. So that's something that we're kind of still working through. This is more just like getting the baseline of like what is the, like in a normal kind of recruitment context, what's the cost? But I think that's something that I'm definitely open to, like how other people are thinking about in terms of like, how do you quantify the cost of like a DeSci project that's using kind of a new model to find people, right? Because like there are costs that, you know, aren't in the traditional model, in a DeSci model. So I think that's kind of a question we're actively working through and curious what others think.
Other people? Who else? Anyone want to, Omid or Charles? Joel, Jackson, Elijah, Danica, Peter. Awesome. Well, yeah, I mean, I think like let's see if you can get like a data point of some sort, if possible, and we can sort of talk more about that next week. How are you thinking about analyzing the data?
I mean, I think that the traditional analysis, and I could share, is kind of like the funnel analysis of like, you know, you build up to like a few hundred dollars per patient via like it's a certain CPM for ads, and then there's like conversion through to recruitment. So that's the data on the traditional recruitment side. I think on like the DSI side, when you're using a token model and kind of a registry, yeah, I haven't really figured out how to like quantify that as much, right? It's something that I'd be curious kind of how others are thinking about that. Like if you have a token and you have costs associated with the project, like how do you quantify the cost of bringing on new folks?
What's your CAC or whatever it's called? Yes.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, cool. Well, maybe we need like a business guy or person here. I guess you are the business person in this context.
Yeah, but, I mean, I have thoughts on it, but like it's a large.
But yeah, maybe talking with Danica or Charles, who have a lot of experience with DAOs, and maybe there's some some CAC analysis that you guys could talk about.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I'll reach out.
Awesome. Anyone else? Okay. Next up, we have Rakan from HackAge.
And we aim to remove advanced glycation end products. And one of our ideas is to... Hello, we are HackAge, and we aim to remove advanced glycation end products. And one of our ideas is to have the enhanced version of Glyoxylase 1 to remove methylglyoxal in the context of diabetic kidney disease. To have this engineered glyoxylase, we're using a computational directed evolution pipeline. However, we need to validate the pipeline. And to do that, we need to find suitable data sets. And what kind of data do I need? So it has to be derived from a rational design experiment. It has to be performed on a common model enzyme where the impact of amino acid substitutions is measured in relation to enzymatic activity. And when I say enzymatic activity, I mean concrete, measurable, quantitative metrics. I asked AI to find me data sets using the four criteria, and it pointed me towards two databases that contain exactly the kind of information that I was looking for.
Hmm.
Secondly, we started engineering Glyoxylase 1, and so far we've made 227 variants to test computationally. Thank you very much.
All right, Rakan is here with us. Good use on using AI to find the data sets. So did you not know, or did you not know of these
enzyme
of these the databases beforehand?
No. I outlined my criteria. Excuse then I realized me. That they make a perfect prompt. That's why I decided to ask an AI. I did not use ChatGPT. I used Perplexity. And and it pointed me towards these two databases, and they seem to be quite useful.
Can you explain what Perplexity is to people?
Okay, Perplexity is an AI tool. What is different about Perplexity is that it gives you references as well. So unlike ChatGPT, it does not only generate text, but it actually justifies what it says by providing references.
Ah, and so you found these through that?
Yes, exactly.
Oh, very cool. So that will probably be really helpful for everybody here. So everyone should check out Perplexity if you don't know about it already. And anyone else have any questions?
Yeah, regarding data generation and analysis with my project is quite straightforward. However, I'm having difficulties with community building.
I was looking.
Yeah, so if anyone has additional like hints or pointers for community building, that would be quite helpful.
So what sort of things do you want from your community?
Well, I basically need domain expertise. And well, judging from my last interaction with cohort members, I realized that maybe doing copy paste and reaching out to people with the same text is not a good strategy. So what I need to do is personalize it a little bit. Secondly, Twitter maybe is not the best platform, and I'm thinking that maybe I should reach out to people on LinkedIn, which is a more specialized platform. Yeah, apart from that, DAO building seems to be quite difficult because all the DAOs that I've been a member of, they had the community already when I joined, and I don't know how to start. You know.
Interesting. Do people have advice for Rakan? I mean, maybe your project is very specific, and so you're targeting such a small group of people. Maybe you need to figure out a way to increase your funnel. In what that means is basically like figure out a way to simplify your project so that you can scope it to more people, so that you can attract more of the type of person you're looking for. Like basically your search beam right now is way too narrow. So you're not picking up the types of people and getting second order effects of recruiting people. So is there a way of like broadening your project to attract more people?
Well, yes. However, I am at the crossroads now because for the past few months, basically I've been managing my project as a company, as a decentralized company. And maybe I should revamp it as a DAO because that was my initial vision. However, it has a very specific angle because we are focused on the extracellular matrix. And setting up Telegram channels and Discord servers, I don't believe it's sufficient because I need to reach out to people and kind of make them know that we exist. It's going to take months, I think, before we get a large enough community. So is there like a way to expedite the process?
Let's see. and does anyone have any advice for Rakan? I mean, I would say maybe simplify it, or maybe you're searching, where are you looking now to recruit people?
I'm having a few ideas. Also, besides Twitter, there are established DAOs, and there's a Longevity Biotech Fellowship, which is I'm a member of. So I could try reaching out to people there as well. So basically, target the longevity community, which is very much DeSci oriented. I hope that people join out of curiosity, at least. Yeah, and
One other idea is like go outside the Web3 longevity community and start looking in other groups, like just traditional science. So don't think of like, sometimes when you're in the Web3 space, it just can be too small and insular, and it's the same group of people. So I think it sort of gets again to the point before, is like broaden who you're trying to reach, like expand your scope of who fits this, or change or broaden your project. I mean, I think you might have to make some changes, but like reach out to people that are slightly outside.
Okay. I'll think about that.
Like for example, yeah. I mean, does anyone else have advice for him?
I mean, I don't know. I found personally, like, it's good to get the word out broadly, but also, like, if you have anyone in your circle, any friends who might know people who would be interested, they're way more likely to respond to you. And then the people, if they recommend anyone, are more likely to respond to you if you reach out to them individually with, like, a personal message. And then, because you kind of, I feel like you need a critical mass of at least a few people, right, before it's likely that people will join just from posts. That's what I've found helpful.
Okay.
Great advice.
There's always debate too, like, how many financial incentives do you kind of build into your DAO? You know, a lot of the DAOs that launched, like, back in 2020 or early 2021, there were a lot of members of the DAOs that were just there for, you know, the financial speculation. There were, like, ERC-20 token drops. And, you know, I don't think that incentive is as powerful as it was, like, during the bull market, obviously. But, you know, that's always going to be part of a DAO, right? You know, I don't think any DAO is, like, perfectly purified of those motives or those speculators, right? So, but it's something to keep in mind, right? Like, some of that is okay, or some gamification, even if these people are not part of, like, the core team or super passionate about the cause. You know, they might become that, right? If they get in the front door, at least, for what it's worth.
Yeah, and then you know, kind of just going off of, you know, what Michael says, like, you know, trying to reduce the scope, or at least making it the project easier to understand for more general audience. That's that always helps. And, you know, just like right now, since, you know, you're kind of just kind of getting started and going, like, it's fine to be small. Like, you know, the group itself is also going to be, like, really small. And even as you know, Joel's talking about, you have the bull run, the DAOs, you have a lot of people coming, but then eventually they went because, you know, the final sense kind of went away. But it's always going to be, like, just a small core team to start everything out. So, like, you know, I wouldn't even really worry about, again, a lot of people. Really just wants people who are, you know, have that intrinsic motivation, who actually want to see the project do well. And, you know, you can bring those people in, it'll be just a couple to start. So, like, that's what really all you need. And then everything else will kind of, you know, kind of flow from there. So I wouldn't, you know, you don't really need to rush it. Just let it, you know, kind of slowly, organically grow.
Agreed. And building off Charles's point, yeah, make it easier to understand, I think. Like, make it, like, maybe you can do some sort of, you know, dumbing it down a little bit so that people can understand it without being an expert in this field. But I know that's what you're looking for, is that expert person, like those two or three experts. But
yeah, at this point, I'm primarily looking for experts. Yeah, and I showed you my write-up for the DAO. Yeah, and since we've been around for several months, we have all kinds of text designed for a whole range of different audiences. So we'll have something very simple and something on the expert level. So currently, we are building our pipeline, so that's why it's a bit technical. Yeah, but the overall vision is quite simple to grasp. It's an extracellular matrix, and it's to make us live longer and healthier. That's it.
Yeah, and something that's could you know, also help with that. So you could have, like, a really short two pager which just explains the project, and then you could have, like, a longer deck if people want to, like, really dive in. So if someone just wants, like, very quick short information, there's a two pager. But you want to learn more and generally be more for the experts, you have, like, a longer deck.
Yeah, awesome. Well, drop those links in the chat, and hopefully we can give you some feedback on that.
Okay, thank you.
Awesome. All right, digital round of applause for RockCon. And next up, we have Elijah with CGD.
We're going to move into talking about some data. So I've been gathering metadata about numerous data sources in this Airtable. I've got about 60, a little bit more right now, a bunch of open access journals, molecular databases, podcasts, other different things I'm scraping and downloading, collecting a bunch of data that way that I'm going to be analyzing and getting there in terms of downloading and exploring the data. This is going to be using mostly to answer that research question of how do I predict effects of various cannabis products, and then trying to use the genetic data as well as a set of molecular data along with experience reports that we're collecting using this survey powered by DBDAO. And this survey is based upon the Subjective Effects Index developed by Psychonaut Wiki. So they have some experience reports there on their website, but this is essentially designed to be more rigorous and gather data in a more standardized format than the existing alternatives that are out there, like Leafly or Weed Maps, which are essentially just like random user reviews. There's not really a rhyme or reason to them, and so we're really trying to create a little bit more of a standard around this and develop this experience report to capture standardized information that can be rich data and used for a more rigorous scientific analysis. So I've entered two responses into this survey, and then I got one other person to enter a response so far, and I've gotten a couple others to commit in DMs and mention that they're going to respond to the survey, so at least I should have some more data coming in, and then I'll be able to start running my analysis.
Very cool. You got some data. That's great. Congratulations, Elijah. Elijah is here. Yes, there you are.
It's really it's not hard to generate data for this survey.
Let me see here. I was just trying to see what the specifics of the row. What data were you collecting specifically? So you had age, height, weight, strain. What else was there?
Yeah, I haven't added data anymore to supplement the what was in the experience report template. Basically getting that demographic data. Then you get like a timeline of their experience. So, you know, when they took the dose, like what type of dose it was, like what their consumption method was, how many milligrams, if it was a specific like product that mentioned like, you know, THC or CBD content. That's usually all they get at this point. I'm going to potentially add a way to add a URL. Well, I did have like a product URL that I could get added, so I could look it up and try and find the testing data. Sometimes these companies they'll put the the data on their website, but you have to know the batch number and things like that. So I started realizing that after I made the survey. So I'm going to update it so that people can include that batch information, and we can get the certificate of analysis, the actual testing data on what they consumed, and map it to their experience. Just kind of building on that template that I got from the Psychonaut Wiki, and then just a lot of demographic data. Just basically it's a free form response, you know, describing your experience, but it's got suggestions in terms of providing a timeline and how to describe it. And I think it was Danica that suggested I look into Qualia Research Institute last time. So thank you, because that's what led me to that. Because they have like an article about how to write a rigorous, you know, subjective experience report, like how to actually do it. And so I included that in the, you know, in the lower part of the page. So if somebody's interested, they can dive into it and really get, you know, good at it. Like I'm going to be practicing writing really rigorous reports, and so I can help people do this going forward. But I think, I want it to be easy so that if somebody doesn't care and they just want to answer, they can just do it. But if they want to dive in and you know, continue like expanding on that format, then they can do that as well.
Amazing. Danica, Jackson, Julian, what do you need help with at the moment, Elijah?
I need more data.
More data. Okay. So figuring out how, but Jackson, do you have anything you want to say?
Oh yeah, of course. I think the way you're trying to collect the experience reports is really interesting. I'd love to talk with you offline a bit more about it, Elijah.
Yeah, please. Thank you. I spoke to a friend who's like a clinical neuropsychologist, and said they were going to, like, some of the language is a little complicated, so we're going to try and like simplify some of the descriptions of experiences. So their like Subjective Effects Index had like this whole list of different effects and their descriptions and things that are associated with cannabis. This whole wiki is like, you know, geared around that. So they have the whole index of the effects. So there's four different categories of effects. There's auditory, visual, physical, and cognitive. And so just simplifying some of the language around those, so that when somebody does do it, they can easily just click the right thing and not wonder what something is and ignore it. So things like that, I'm kind of just trying to refine it a little bit. So I think maybe what I need help with is more data, getting this out there. And then I think I'm gonna just, and then we'll see what happens when I start trying to use AI to analyze it. Maybe I can just throw it all in there too.
Do you think if you paid people $10 to do it, that would be a good, bad, or uncertain idea?
I don't know. I mean, I feel like people would probably do it. It's pretty, you know, people are getting paid to consume cannabis. I think they would jump on that.
Interesting. Would they be interested, do you think, in like future parts being some sort of reward as part of the project?
Yeah, I mean, I guess that is kind of the point. I'm trying not to commit myself to anything too early. But that's kind of why I wanted to, you know, why DBDAO was so attractive was that, you know, I can do this NFT minting thing, where in that when I use this data and list it on the marketplace, that these people can basically come and claim like a dividend.
Amazing.
Elijah, have you ever thought about working with like dispensaries? I feel like this data would be very, very interesting to them, as it's like a product that they're trying to sell, especially if it's a strain that they, you know, sell almost on a proprietary basis. I can see that being a good incentive, working with them to provide a possible incentive, because they would also be interested in that data. And obviously providing cannabis to consumers is also what they're good at.
Right, definitely. Yeah, Michael actually asked the same question, and he's like, what would be the best way to like distribute this? I'm like, I should just go into dispensaries and like ask them if I can stick a QR code like on the door when people are walking out or something. You know, but yeah, I definitely think I have good relationships with the local dispensaries here from the testing business, and then some other ones I guess I can try and reach out to. So yeah, it's a good idea.
Yeah, I just had a question. Since you're using DBDAO, are you also mentioning to the respondents of the survey that they can get the NFT as a reward for completing the survey, and then possibly have you also had difficulty having to like describe what an NFT is, like how do you access it, what can you do with it?
I have had some trouble with that. Actually, I've been meaning to reach out in the DBDAO Telegram because the minting feature wasn't working. But on the website, the Cannabis Genome.dao website, basically when you, it does include a link to the data below, because I'll kind of make that more prominent later on. I didn't want people to kind of dive into the data right now and see that there's only three responses. Which, you know, that's why I'm trying to just get some early responses in there. But it does show in that table a link to, or it will, it shows the field for it. Right now the field's empty, but it will show a link to the NFT right there. So when somebody goes and looks at the data, they can see it there. It is, you know, so they can go click on it and see that, you know, they, I don't know how that feature works actually, because it's not, I can't do the minting, but yeah.
If you right click the cell,
right,
or the row, it'll mint it. You have to deposit money into, test ETH into the wallet for that address, which I will show you how to do. And then it has the gas to be able to fund that.
Okay,
and then it'll mint that row. But okay. I'll show you how that works.
Okay, that's why. Yeah, I just kept throwing an error when I clicked mint.
Yeah, interesting.
And I think it's the mail service, I think it was throwing an error as well when I was asking if they'd like to send me a copy of responses, and it was saying the mail service isn't
interesting. Back end.
So yeah, I want to, yeah, a couple bug reports.
Got it. I will let me know about that. I'll fix that. Cool. One other question I had is, do you think that was there any pushback from filling out the survey? Like, when would it be easier to do the survey in chat, or do you like to do it? Do people want to respond free text in a chat form, or would they prefer in like a chat messaging system, or would they prefer doing the form filling it out? Do you think? Or does it not matter?
I don't know if it would matter. I think maybe that might increase reach, but I don't know if it would have a better conversion rate or not.
Got it.
Yeah.
That's something Danica and I were discussing, is like different modalities of gathering information and how that changes response rate, yada, yada, yada.
Mm-hmm.
Or not, you know. But I think this is something that's pretty interesting.
Yeah, that's something I was thinking about too, because there's 25 questions on there. And so I definitely want to potentially, if I can narrow it down and make it shorter. I keep just telling people, this will only take me 5 minutes so they don't get off put when they look at it and see 25 questions.
This
is a super cool survey. And like, I love that you're putting in the work to figure out what's the best way to get at these like very subjective experiences, but it also is a lot of demand on people's time. I wonder if there's a way you could pitch it where it's also kind of a benefit to the participant. Like people spend a lot of time reflecting on their experiences. So you could almost do it from like a psychonaut angle of like, here's an opportunity for you to like sit down and reflect on what the substance was like for you.
Right, absolutely. And journaling is the most common like method that a clinical practitioner right now has for to basically get at what is going to be the best product for a particular patient, because there's no like in clinical practice right now, like a nurse or a doctor will see a patient and be like, this is, you know, what was your experience? And you have to sort of track that and what you were using. And so that the journaling is like their main tool. And that's kind of how I'm pitching it to a few people that I know. It's like, hey, I'm going to start using this as my personal like experience log. Go ahead. I would love it if you did that too. Like, I think it could be really useful for you. I think that's probably the way I'm going to try and approach the messaging around this.
No, that's a really good point. And like, that's like an additional incentive to use, to actually fill out the survey. It's like, well, it's just part of your experience and something that you're already doing. It's like, yeah, just keep adding to it.
Right, like I'm using it because I want to get better at describing and being able to do that myself, right? So I have that like really down, and I can sort of help guide other people too if they get stuck there.
I think that just adds like a really nice educational component to it as well for people.
Yeah, thank you.
I think that's super interesting. So like basically the distinction between like journaling versus filling out a survey, like from 1,000 miles, those look very different. Those look very similar, but from like the way you pitch it to someone is like a very different thing. That's very interesting.
Yeah. So maybe a different interface would help make it a little bit more fluid. But...
Oh, interesting. What about like a, What type of interface are you thinking?
I have no idea. I'm just thinking, because you mentioned the survey and like the chat interface. I'm like, I don't know what else. How to present that.
Like
a page where you flip through, maybe it's all on one page or something, and so it's, I don't know, like make it easier to digest.
I'm thinking maybe like a guided chat bot could be interesting. I'm not married to this idea, but if there's something that was a little bit more, I feel like the problem with the UI of the forms a little bit is like it feels like you're filling out a form. And a journal is cool because it's a little bit more free form, but then also you has the pros and cons of like looking at a blank page for some people can be a bit intimidating.
Yeah.
So maybe right. There's some sort of like in between where it's like a blank page and then you stop and then the bot says like, tell me more about this, or sort of guides you a little bit more interactively. Mm-hmm. But I think this insight of like the journaling versus the filling out the form is like a very, it says then you're doing it for yourself and then you're also contributing to science.
Right.
And do other people have a thought on that?
Yeah, like I was saying, I think it's like a really, interesting point that's, you're both raising, just trying a different interface, one that's definitely that's more amenable to the actual person. And I can't really say like which interface is necessarily better, because I know at least with the survey you're trying to get like specific information, which you might not get if someone's doing something that's like really free form. But then on the flip side, with the free form, people can be more reflective. That's kind of like what Michael was saying. We had some guided chatbot, or even trying to think of note-taking apps where you write down your notes and then might like the AI will just give you like a recommendation, like, oh, you wrote about this, oh, can you talk more about that, or you wrote about this, or like, well, you probably shouldn't do that. But something like that I think could be like really helpful in that regard. And if I can remember the name of like one of these notes apps, I'll just put it in the Telegram. Mm.
Cool, thank you. Yeah.
Amazing. Well, I think we had a really some really good insights there. So
yeah, thank you.
Digital applause for Elijah and Co. and Charles and Danica and everyone else that Joel, everyone that pitched in there. Okay, next up we have Nima with Longlist.
Nima from Longlist team, and in this video we are going to talk about how we actually gather the data and especially about DeSci projects. There's a sample of three DeSci projects that are listed under the subcategory of DeSci. As you can see, BetaDAO, LabDAO, and Research Hub, all the necessary data about the projects, their description, their founders, their founding date, and all their social medias are listed here. The data about the funding rounds they've had are also listed here, and you can access them. The view here is actually in Airflow, and it's like Airtable. It's showing Airtable, but we are going to have this data completely and totally on DBDAO. We can implement all the data there. We can visualize the data and compare all the DeSci projects together, their funding rounds, their social medias, what they're doing, and actually the way they are going to improve and how can they be compared to each other. Can be totally seen in some simple charts. And that's all the way we are gathering data. We use the most updated websites and PR news sites and all the AI and robots that are available in the Twitter space to gather all these data. Some of our resources are premium, and we've gathered all of them in one place to have the most updated database of DeSci projects here.
Excellent. Is anyone from the Longlist team here? I know that's a tricky one from a time zone perspective, but is anyone here from them? I mean, I think it's great. I think I wonder about the incentive, and I think for that one where you really want like real time data, figuring out if the NFT and if the incentive, figuring out like understanding the incentive mechanism to drive data collection, would be really, really interesting, and maybe a study with a user could enable that, or just talking to some people. But anyway, I'm curious. And yeah, if you're watching this after, we can help you get onto DBDAO from the Airflow. As a matter of fact, we can just import that whole Airflow into the DBDAO system. So don't worry about that. But does anyone else have a question? And I'll reach out to you about that. Does anyone else have a question for Nima?
I have a question. It's a general question regarding DeSci. So I was wondering, like, how many DeSci DAOs that have been able to fundraise are out there, and what is the half-life of a DeSci DAO? And this is just for my curiosity.
Cool. So. Nima and Longlist team, hopefully you guys can maybe you can answer that question in the chat when you review. I know they like to watch the video after, so we'll post the video and they can respond in the chat, and then we can all learn about the half-life of a community. I think that's a great question too. Understanding, and I think Charles and Danica would also appreciate sort of understanding if you're tracking all this qualitative data, like those, maybe we can feed that into some of those other projects as well. Anybody else? But yeah, I think that's a great point, Rakan. Maybe there's ways of thinking about like how we can incorporate this data or promote it within other projects as well, as being pretty interesting. Peter? Ahmed? Okay. Well, thank you, Nima. That sounds really interesting. I am excited that see how that's coming along. And next up, we have Eddie with.
Hi, everyone.
Let me just let that load for a second. Let me just make sure I liked this other guy. I want to make sure. Did we?
Hello, guys. It's Nino from Longestime.
Okay, yes, we did. Okay. And then Eddie from DeSci Blocks.
Hi, everyone. Eddie here with DeSci Block. Coming with to answer the question on data and regarding data collection and data usage. So DeSci Block is not inherently a data collecting process. Ideally, it is a data collaboration tool that allows people from different DAOs and different projects to contribute their data in order to give access to other data, sort of acting as an intermediary, saying party A has access, provides data that is being able to use to other people that have provided their data. So, and that the goal of it is to allow for collaboration, because as many scientists do tend to have data that works well together. For example, people studying nutrition versus sleep versus fitness, many of those are very correlated. And once you have a larger picture, it provides better insight on it or better backing for research. So all in all, that is the idea of the data process. Most of the data process is some sense to be held by each user through a service like ORT or even through DBDAO to then be used by every other contributor to answer larger questions via the large language model that will be retrained on your data, plus the data you're requesting from the other individuals that are providing it. All right, thanks. Talk to you soon.
Excellent. I mean, Eddie, my question for Eddie is like, I want to know like an example of something that a question someone could ask, like how like a use case. It doesn't have to be like every use case, but just like one use case of how it could be potentially used. Does anyone else have a question for Eddie? Eddie is not here. I think he also is a bit tricky. Awesome. Okay. But yeah, looks cool. Hopefully, I'm excited to see the UI for that project. And I think one data point that you could actually collect is, you know, understanding how researchers want to collaborate and share data. So like maybe you could put together a survey or do some user interviews around like what types of things people want to do. And that could just, you don't have to take the advice directly, but that could inform like what sort of things you're going to build for, what sort of UIs or interfaces. And definitely also, Eddie, check out Code Interpreter, like we talked about at the beginning. I think that'll be like an interesting thing to see how you can compare and contrast with that and, you know, utilize that to make your thing amazing as well. Okay. Last but not least, anything else they want to say? Anybody? I think we had some really good insights around the journaling in particular. I think that was a really good way of framing, because it sounds like obviously like people have questions around like, how do I get more people to fill out my survey? And this reframes it as like, oh, let me build a tool for allowing someone to explore themselves and then use that data. I mean, that's kind of like what Facebook or Instagram does, is like a tool for you to share and then Facebook like collects the data. Maybe we should be reframing our thoughts in terms of like, what sort of thing can we build for somebody? And then how can like that data be useful for science as a whole, as opposed to fill out my survey? Maybe that's just like a good way of like reframing things. Anyone else have a quick thought, and then we'll wrap up. Elijah, Joel, Julian, Kaiosu, Charles, Omid, Peter, Rakan, Danica. Okay, and then lastly, I wanted to mention, we're gonna try and do like a little bit of a media push. So I sent out a form and I'll drop that link again. Most people have filled it out, but some, I don't think we have everyone filled it out yet. So it's really basic. It's like the project name, a one-liner, an abstract, the team. And we're gonna try and propagate that around and get a little bit of media about it to help you guys out. And so if you haven't done that, fill it out. I'll drop it in the chat as well. Okay, I think that's all for now. And thank you all for coming. Don't forget about the video next time on data analysis. I think this will be very interesting. Try and use ChatGPT. If you don't use ChatGPT, you can use something else as well. But excellent work so far and really done. Over the halfway point, so almost there. Just keep up the pace. Keep getting excited. Keep using the chat. And see you guys on Tuesday. Thank you, guys. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.